Sally, now our last but not least speaker is Ms. Tania Abbiate. Ms. Tania comes from Bologna University, Faculty of Political Sciences, Statistics and Law. Her presentation is going to deal with the timely subject of the mechanisms available to NGOs in order to protect human rights in front of constitutional courts. Ms. Abbiate, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much for your invitation and your warm hospitality. It is a great pleasure to be here and present my paper that deals with the interaction between civil society and the judiciary. And more precisely, my aim is to investigate the engagement of NGOs in the judicial litigation in front of three constitutional courts, namely those of South Africa, Canada, and India. In fact, this legal system sets specific procedures in order to access to justice for the protection of human rights, and I have analyzed two main mechanisms that are the amicus curiae and the public interest litigation. They are structurally different. In particular, the amicus curiae identifies a person or a group that is structurally external to the trial, but who takes part to it as third parties and has to respect some requirements normally set in the rules of procedure of the constitutional courts. Its role consists mainly in highlighting aspects that have not been arisen by the parties, and normally now it supports one party in the trial. Instead, the public interest litigation consists in the direct launch of a lawsuit by an individual or an NGO that acts in his own right or on behalf of some larger group of people. And this instrument is particularly developed in India, where there is a particular interpretation of this tool as an institutional voice for the poor and disadvantaged group of society. As we can see, these two legal actions are structurally different, but they are both carried out by interest groups that protect collective rights, and therefore I consider them as two kind of legal action for the protection of human rights. First, I analyze the legal framework that is conducive to litigation, in order to understand the context in which these interventions are set. And then I have chosen some significant case law dealing with economic and social rights. And I will pass quickly through the case I have analyzed. And looking to South Africa, I would like to point out that both amicus curiae and public interest litigation are possible. These two kind of intervention are regulated by different provision. In particular, the amicus curiae is regulated by the rules of procedure 10 of the Constitutional Court, while the legal basis for the public interest litigation is Article 38 of the Constitution. So NGOs here have both the possibility to access to justice, and I have chosen to present the case of Matsibuko against the city of Johannesburg. I have no time to deepen this case. However, it deals with the introduction of a new water policy that replaced the system that was used before. And it provides a free water basic supply for indigent people. And this supply is considered to be insufficient to meet the basic need of the poor that live in a particular area of Johannesburg. And since the system that has been introduced is a credit system, so people had to pay before use the water, this measure is considered to be discriminatory because they are poor black people and the white rich people are receiving deemed supply of water. So they access to justice and they are supported by an international NGO that is called Center on Housing Rights and Eviction. And the lawsuit is highly debated. At the end, the court ruled against the applicant, and therefore it is highly criticized. But this case can draw some lessons about litigation. In this case, it appears that litigation was the only strategy available, all other avenues being exhausted. And so we can see that litigation is a valuable strategy. Moreover, at the end, the litigation stimulated the public awareness and the political mobilization, and therefore politicians delivered to the resident of the area what they were asked for in the litigation, even if the judgment was unfavorable to them. So it can be a success even if in the lawsuit they lost. And okay, turning to Canada, I have to point out that even in this context, both amicus curiae, that here is called intervention, the idea is of third-party intervention, and the public interest litigation are possible. However, since the Supreme Court has developed quite strict requirement to the public interest litigation, the most frequent mechanism that is used is that of third-party intervention. And the case I have analyzed is the case Gosselin against Quebec, that deals with a workfare policy and with the right to an adequate standard of social assistance. In fact, the policy reduced the basic social assistance amount of almost two-thirds to unemployed young people under 30, and the aim was to promote their long-term autonomy and their engagement in workfare and in working and training opportunity. But of course, this policy has been criticized, and some people access to justice in order to obtain justice. And at the end, the court dismissed their claims. And so it is a really disappointment for the interveners that supported the case. But even in this case, we can have some lessons. In particular, the court left open the possibility of a future interpretation of the right to security of the person as including the right to an adequate standard of social assistance. So in a certain case, litigation has been useful to the applicant. And finally, coming to India, I have already mentioned that public interest litigation is the most used instrument to access to justice, and it has been particularly developed by the judiciary, that has liberalized its rule of standing, has adopted a quite loose. Rules of accessing it, and in particular, it is characterized by the procedural and remedial flexibility, and this means that the court adopts a quite a bundle of remedies that bring a concrete benefit to the poor. And the example I have analyzed is the case People Union Civil Liberties against Union of India, that has brought to the reformer recognition of the right to an adequate food. And has also brought to an implementation of laws and program dealing with food distribution, and therefore it is a well recognized success of litigation. So coming to the conclusion, my aim has been to show the feature and advantages of engaging in judicial litigation. And as we can see, as we can see, the outcome of the of this strategy is unpredictable because it's up to the court how they judge the cases. But however, engaging in this kind of strategy can have indirect effect. It contributes to policy formation. It gives visibility to issues that would otherwise remain hidden. And at the end, it contributes to democratic participation because even extrajudicial actors such as NGOs can participate to the judicial process. And therefore, I think that this strategy is worth, even if NGOs have to have specific knowledges and financial resources, of course, to engage in this kind of strategy. So thank you very much. And
Ms. Abbiate, thank you very much for your presentation. As you mentioned, the whole your paper deals with the contribution of civil society in protecting the human rights, NGOs and civil society, the instruments that the civil society has disponible to protect human rights. You brought in your papers many examples, cases and practices just to demonstrate the contribution of civil society to get collective rights realized. Thank you very much once more. Please, any question or any short comment?